Dear friends, greetings in Jesus' name. The title of today's message that I want to present before you is The Concoction of the Cups. Concoction of the Cups. And just to begin my message, I want to read one verse from John's Gospel, 18 chapter, verses 10 and 11. Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup which the Father has given me? Shall I not drink the cup which the Father has given me?" Dear friends, in the Synoptic Gospels, they speak very graphically about Jesus' ordeal in Gethsemane. When Jesus entered into the Garden of Gethsemane before his crucifixion, he left a few disciples at the gate, and he took Peter, James, and John, and he went into the garden. He began to be sorrowful. He said, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful unto death." And he wanted the three disciples to watch and pray with them. They slept. Jesus went again into the garden farther, and he just went and fell on his face and prayed to God the Father. And he said, "Father, if this cup will not pass away from me, except to drink of it, let your will be done and not mine." So, dear friends, here we see Jesus speaking about a cup. And when the enemies of Jesus came to capture him in the Garden of Gethsemane, Peter, who claimed initially that he'll go with Jesus in prison and also die for him, he took his sword. He wanted to fight against the enemies of the Lord Jesus Christ. He cut the ear of Malchus. And Jesus said, "Put your sword into his own sheath. Shall I not drink the cup which the Father has given me?" Now, what are the cups? What is the cup that Jesus was given by God the Father? And I want to speak about this in this message. I want to deal with these things under four subheadings. The first is cup offered to Jesus by the Heavenly Father. The second is cup offered to us by Jesus Christ. The third is cup offered by the Mystery Babylon, the mother of harlots, the world. And the fourth is cup of God's fury. So if the first point is the cup offered to Jesus by the Heavenly Father. What was the cup that signified when Jesus was given that cup in the Garden of Gethsemane? The cup spoke about, cup represented all the sin and sins of humanity. God created man with his own volitional will and power of choice. Man chose to be away from God. He began to follow the demons, and they began to commit sin against God. And God's heart was so unhappy, and he sent his own son, Jesus Christ, to die for us on the cross. So that vessel represented the sin and sins of the whole world. When Jesus Christ was on the cross, morning 9 o'clock he was crucified. He died at 3 o'clock on the cross. Between 12 o'clock to 3 o'clock there was darkness over the whole world. And that was the time I perceived Jesus as suffering the pangs of hellfire. Jesus knew why he came into this world. He knew he had to lay down his life and take it up back. He was willing to do that. He had power to do that. But what ailed him was, his sorrow was, during that hours on the cross, his soul had to be separated from God the Father. When Jesus was crucified on the cross, he began to say, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." He was able to address God, Father. But later, between 12 o'clock and 3 o'clock, when the darkness came over the whole world, I perceived that Jesus was suffering in hellfire, tasting hellfire for everyone, tasting death for everyone, being separated from God the Father. Jesus had to take upon his own body, the sin and sins of the whole world. That was the cup that he had to drink. And when he prayed to God the Father three times in Garden of Gethsemane, God did not answer. God did not say, "Okay, don't drink it." God knew he had to drink it. Jesus took it upon him. He drank it and he died on the cross. And as he was, just before his death, as he was suffering the pangs of hell, as he was separated from God the Father, he began to cry and say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" He was not able to address God, Father. Because sins came upon him, he became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. So this was the cup that was given to the Lord Jesus Christ. And Satan did not want him to drink that cup. As Jesus was telling the disciples that they had to go to Jerusalem and he'll be caught by the people and they will torture him and crucify him. And Peter took him aside and he rebuked him and said, let it be far from you, Lord. This will not happen to you. You know, he thought, Peter thought he was helping Jesus Christ, and he did not want Jesus Christ to suffer on the cross. But Jesus told him and said, get thee behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. I tell you, friends, this is what happens when we come to the Lord. This is what we should understand when we come to the Lord Jesus Christ. He drank the cup that was offered to him, cup of sin of the whole world. Every drop he drank. Then only he was able to, he could go to the cross and die. So, dear friends, the cup that God offered to Jesus was offered for us. God forsook his own son on the cross, took upon him our own children, took upon us as his own children. This is what we should understand. The second cup that I want to talk about is the cup offered to us by the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus died, and the hell was not able to hold him for long, and the grave was not able to hold him for long. Third day he rose again. Rose again he went to God the Father, and he sent his Holy Spirit. Now, dear friends, before his death, Jesus told about the cup that he is going to offer to the people. So if you read the first day's cup of his blood, Mark's Gospel 14th chapter, if you read 23rd and 24th verses, then he took the cup during the last supper. He took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said unto them, this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. So Jesus offers us his blood, and we are to drink it, meaning his blood is the way of remission of our sins. We have to take that cup. Matthew's Gospel 26 chapter, verses 27 to 28. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. So, dear friends, if our sins should be forgiven, we have to receive this cup. The second cup that Jesus offers to us is the living water. If you read John's Gospel, 7th chapter, verses 37 to 39, on the last day of the feast, great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone is thirsty, let him come unto me and drink, and he who believes in me, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water. Before the living water could be provided for the whole world, before the Holy Spirit could come on the day of Pentecost, Jesus was telling about the cup that he is going to offer to people, the cup of the living water. So, dear friends, when we receive Jesus as our Savior, receive the cup of the blood of Jesus, and accept the salvation that is given to us, our sins are forgiven. You are expected to walk in the path of holiness and grow into the path of holiness, grow in sanctification till we meet the Lord Jesus Christ when he comes back. Now, the point is, we have to receive the cup of living water. The anointing of the Holy Spirit must be in us. Only when we have the gift of the Holy Spirit, only when we have anointing of the Holy Spirit, we will be in a position to walk in the right path. So, dear friends, Jesus offers to us his own blood and the cup of living water he gives. He said, whoever is willing, let him come and drink. If you are thirsty, you can go and drink. You know, many people have no thirst for the living waters. So, if you are really longing for the anointing of the Holy Spirit, he is willing to give it to you. Once you are saved, Holy Spirit comes in. You'll have to continue to obey him and walk in his path so that your life will be filled with the Holy Spirit on a daily basis. The third cup that God wants to offer to us through Jesus Christ is cup of his will. If you look at Acts of the Apostle 9th chapter, 15 and 16 verses, in that particular chapter we read about Saul, who became Paul, meeting the Lord Jesus as he was going towards Damascus. So he was persecuting the church. The Lord Jesus touched him. He was transformed. He was asked to go and pray in Damascus, wait in Damascus. And the Lord told Ananias, one of his disciples, and he said, go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before the Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. For I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake. And the Lord was willing to give him a cup. It was his will. It was God's will for him. So, dear friends, St. Paul had that cup given to him. He knew that he had to suffer for the Lord. He is a vessel chosen by me, the Lord Jesus said. So when we receive salvation of the Lord, He gives us a cup of His own will. You know, many people enter into the ministry these days. Every believer should be able to be part of the ministry that their pastor is doing in the church. That's to be expected. At the same time, many people enter into the ministry as if they're conducting programs. Here we see St. Paul was not given a mission to go and do things in a different way. It was not a bed of roses. The Lord told this particular man, Ananias, I have chosen him as a vessel to suffer for me. So we are vessels in the things of in the kingdom of God. Now God has a will for us, the will of His own the ministry. So doing ministry as a program is not what God wants. God wants you to receive the cup from Him and drink of it. Blessings will be there. You may have to leave many things and follow. You know, when 45 years ago, when Jesus called me for His service, I left everything and followed. The Lord gave me a cup of His own will. All these years, I have seen suffering. I know what is suffering. But at the same time, I was able to drink the cup that God has given to me, cup of His will for His own glory, to do His ministry with all my heart. I want to drink every drop of that cup. So, dear friends, if you are involved in God's ministry, just wake up to the reality that you'll have to do God's work in God's will. So, dear friends, God is able to bless you in every way. But don't look to the ministry to receive money from others. Many people preach God's word, a perverted gospel, perverted word of God. They pervert the word of God, preach it in such a way they can get money. So many families are overthrown just for the filthy lucre. Many people destroy God's work. So, dear friends, God has to give to us, God is willing to give to us these cups through the Lord Jesus Christ. Cup of His blood, cup of the living water, and also cup of God's will. When we receive these cups, we'll be able to serve the Lord with all our heart. A day is going to come, all that we do under the guise of ministry is going to be tested. The word of God says, St. Paul says, on that day, that fire will test everything. St. Paul said, I have laid the foundation. Foundation is Jesus Christ. And I am building upon that. And there is no other foundation can be laid. And you build many things on that. And on that particular day, when the Lord Jesus comes back as a judge, every work shall be tested by fire. If it is able to withstand the fire, we will be able to enter into heaven joyfully. So what I'm trying to say is, ministry's aim is not to do some programs. The main burden that we should have is winning souls. When we understand the cup that God had to give to Jesus Christ, we'll be humble. We'll understand why Jesus died on the cross. And then we'll receive joyfully the blood, the cup of the blood of Jesus, and also the cup of the living water, and also cup of His will for our ministry. St. Paul was able to say, I run my course. I've been fighting the battle, fighting the fight of faith. I run my course. I'm going to be poured out as an offering. God's will should be performed in our lives. So, dear friends, every one of us who are in the ministry should understand the will that God has given to us. The third cup that I want to talk about is the cup offered by the mystery Babylon, the mother of harlots. If you read Book of Revelation 17, chapter verses 4 and 5. The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abomination of the earth. This particular woman represents the whole evil of the world. Lust of the eyes, lust of flesh, and pride of life are given to the people from the world. They are not from God. So, dear friends, this cup is given. It appears to be beautiful, appears to be attractive. Many people take from this cup and they destroy their own lives. So, this is what the world offers. People begin to evaluate, okay, if I follow the Lord Jesus Christ, if I have to be holy, I'll have to forsake a lot of things of this world I cannot enjoy. They are not able to perceive that eternal damnation is waiting for them. They are not able to perceive the cup that God offered to the Lord Jesus Christ and what Jesus is offering to us. So they want to drink the cup that is offered to people by the mother of harlots, Babylon. It stands for the sinful condition, sinfulness everywhere. the evil powers backing all the evil of this world. They offer all these nice things. So lust of the eyes, lust of flesh, and pride of life appear to be so sweet, and many people involved in it. And when the word of God is given to such people, they oppose God's word, they resist God's word. They begin to talk that there is no God. They resist God's word. Before the collapse of Soviet Union, in Russia, there was a festival going on. And one program was Jesus in tuxedo. And a Russian came dressed in tuxedo, beautiful suit. And he called himself Jesus in tuxedo. He took in his hand a cup of whiskey or wine. And he was drinking it, telling, "I am drinking the blood of the Lord, blood of Jesus." As he was about to drink it, when he pronounced that he's going to drink it, people were all very happy. They began to clap hands. And this man was giving them a program. And as he was about to drink it, his face became pale. Something was happening in his own body. As he drank it, he fell down and died. So, dear friends, when people drink of the dregs of the cup that was given to them from Babylon, the mother of harlots, this is what will happen. They resist the Lord Jesus Christ. And when people resist the Lord Jesus Christ, damnation is waiting for such people. So, dear friends, many have no desire to come closer to God. Even people who are in the ministry, they preach perverted word of God, perverted gospel, just for money, just to earn money. Many are there. And what are they going to do with that money when they leave this world? So, dear friends, we must be careful to do what God is expecting us to do. Dear friends, we have to understand that when a person is drinking the cup that is offered by the mother of harlots, they'll enter into hellfire. The fourth cup that I want to place before you is the cup of God's fury. Bible speaks about cup of the wrath of God, cup of his fury, cup of his indignation. It is for the wicked, rebellious people, for the unsaved, for those who have fallen from grace. You know, after salvation, many people, they back off from God. They are backslide. They are not willing to come back to the Lord Jesus Christ. Sin hardens their own heart. Satan deceives such people. Even such people will have to face the cup of God's fury. If you read Revelation 22nd chapter, verses 14 to 15, "Blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter through the gates into the city. But outside are dogs, sorcerers, sexually immoral, and murderers and idolaters, and whoever loves and practices a lie." And Revelation 14 chapter 9 to 10, the word of God says, "If anyone worships a beast and his image and receives his mark on his forehead and on his hand, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of holy angels and in the presence of his Lamb." Now, dear friends, this is what is offered to you. I spoke about four concoction of cups. So, dear friends, God offered suffering for the Lord Jesus Christ. Sin of the whole world was given to him. And Jesus offers to us his own blood, living water, and his will. When we are able to do that, we will be really a blessing for other people. Now, what we have to understand is, we should not procrastinate the day of salvation. See, today is the day of salvation. If you are a person who has not received this cup from the Lord, it is imperative that you humble yourself and come closer to the Lord and receive what God has given to you. Many people hear God's word. They look at the things of this world. They procrastinate. There was a young girl who heard God's word. And in the church, when she heard God's word, she was really convicted in her own heart that she should come to God. But she began to evaluate. If I begin to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, I may have to lose a lot of things of this world. So what she did was, she said, "Well, tomorrow I'll do it." She was procrastinating the day of salvation by one day. The next day, she died. She did not wake up the next day. There is another girl who went to a church to hear God's word. She also was convicted of her sins by the word of God. Her aunt, who brought her to the meeting, began to say, "Look here, you follow the Lord Jesus soon. Obey him immediately." This girl said, "Well, next Sunday I'll try to obey." When she went home, she took her diary. She was not able to sleep. The conviction of sin was in her heart. She knew about what will happen to her if she refuses to follow the Lord Jesus. But still the things of this world were pulling her. So took her diary and wrote, next week I'll follow the Lord. She tried to sleep. She couldn't sleep. She again wrote, she stuck it off and wrote again, after 5 days I'll follow the Lord. She couldn't sleep. She said, after 4 days I'll follow the Lord. She began to rewrite again, and she said, tomorrow I'll follow the Lord. That night she died. So, dear friends, these two people have been procrastinating the day of salvation. Many people do that. Now, this is not what is required. When God gave His own Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, are we not willing to follow Him? So, when the Word of God comes to you, follow Him with all your heart. Obey God's Word. And people who are in the ministry should wake up to the reality that God's will should be done. So we must be in a position to say, shall I not drink the cup which the Father has given to me? What type of cup are you holding in your own hand? Cup of the wisdom of this world? Cup of the harlot of this world? Harlots of this world? Cup that is offered to us by Mystery Babylon? What are you trying to do in the presence of God? We have one life, my dear friends. It is imperative that we wake up to the reality, that we come closer to the Lord, understand what He has prepared for us, and then follow Him with all our hearts. Every day, wake up in the morning and spend quality time in prayer. Many people who have problems, physical problems, emotional problems, they connect with me for prayer. When I tell them about prayer, some are not able to pray at all. They're not able to pray. They get entangled in the things of this world. They're not able to pray. My encouragement to you will be, friends, time is precious. God has given to us 24 hours every day. Wake up in the morning. Pray with all your heart. Prayer is important. Pray. Wake up and pray. And be watchful in your prayer. Watch in prayer. And also pray and watch. So God has given us an opportunity to hear God's word today and humble yourself before the Lord. You just tune your own heart to spend time in prayer so that God will be able to give complete victory. So, dear friends, we read about John, who was able to lean onto the bosom of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was willing to follow the Lord all his life. He was earnestly following the Lord. He was able to hear the heartbeat of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, among the 12 disciples, Judas Iscariot committed suicide. And among the other disciples, the first person to be martyred was James, and the last one to die was John. All other disciples were martyred. John was not martyred. He was willing to do anything for the Lord. Any cup you offer, I'll drink. So he was leaning onto the heart of the Lord Jesus Christ, and even he was able to follow the Lord all through the days, even to the cross. Among all the disciples, he was the person who was able to stand by the cross, and he listened to the voice of the Lord Jesus. He was not scared. So John's gospel, he never said all the disciples ran away when the enemies of Jesus came to capture him. He couldn't write because he did not run away. He went out of the garden to bring Peter to Jesus again. And the Peter who said he will go into prison and die for the Lord Jesus, he was trying to follow the Lord Jesus afar off. It was John who was instrumental in bringing Peter to the place where Jesus was before the high priest, as was being bound there, standing bound there. And Peter denied the Lord Jesus Christ. And he was able to look at Jesus. Jesus looked at him. He went out and wept bitterly. John was instrumental. He was always a person who was encouraging others. He was not having any fear at all. So, dear friends, tradition says that John was serving the Lord in many places. And in Ephesus, he was serving the Lord. And also many people were saved. One young man was saved through the ministry of John the Divine. And this young man was earnest for the Lord. Then later, John was sent to Patmos. And as he had to go to Patmos, you know how they tried to send him to Patmos? Initially, they wanted to kill him by offering him a cup of poison. He said, okay, he was not afraid of dying. He received the poison, was very old at that time. John received the poison. Before he could take it to his mouth, it seems the tradition says, the poison became like a flying serpent and flew away. They could not give him poison again. They said, okay, this man will not die this way. They tried to put him in boiling oil. There again, John did not die. So they said, this man cannot be easily killed. They exiled him to Patmos. And he was in Patmos, and he was able to receive tremendous revelations from the Lord. We read about it in the book of Revelation. Now, when he became very old, as he was brought back from Patmos, he came to the particular church and he said, "Where is my spiritual son?" And what happened to that young man who was brought to the salvation by John? He had become a terrorist. He had his own terrorist group. He had his own sword and his arm, and he was trying to kill people. And when John came to the church, he was told that the particular young man had gone away from the Lord Jesus. John ran up as an old man. He ran after him. When this young man who was a terrorist, he was a leader of a terrorist group. He was in a jungle. As John went there, when he heard the voice of John, he wanted to run away. But John ran after him, brought him with tears. And the young man who had become a backslider, he fell at the feet of John. He accepted Jesus again. What I'm trying to say is, John was willing to drink the cup that was offered to him. Come what may, I want to stand for the Lord. So, dear friends, we have only one life that God has given to us. What we have to do for the Lord, we must be willing to do. So, to just recount again, Jesus is offering to us the cup of his own blood. Receive the salvation of the Lord. Our sins are forgiven by the blood of Jesus. After sins are forgiven, sinful nature will be there. To control the sinful nature, we need to have the second cup of the Holy Spirit, the living waters. When the Holy Spirit is there, when we allow the Holy Spirit to control our personality, the sinful nature will be controlled. We have to be found in Christ, walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit, as St. Paul wrote to Romans in 8th chapter, 1st verse. We are to be found in Christ. There is no condemnation for people who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And the third cup is God's will. Without doing God's will, we cannot enter into heaven. On that particular day, many people may go to the Lord Jesus and say, "In your name, we cast out demons and we performed miracles and we prophesy." Jesus will say, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Now, are you a person in that category? So, dear friends, what is needed is receive the cup of God's will. If you do God's will today, tomorrow when Jesus comes back, you'll be able to meet him with all your heart. So, dear friends, which cup are you holding in your own hand? What are you drinking from that cup? May the Lord open your own heart to understand the depth of this message so that you'll obey and do God's will. And when Jesus comes back, you'll be able to meet him with all your heart. Shall we look to God in prayer? Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, and praise you for this joyful time that you've given to us to listen to your voice. Jesus, you died for us on Calvary. You took upon yourself the cup that was offered to you by the Lord, by God the Father, the sin and sins of the whole humanity. You were not willing, but you took it, O God. And you're offering to us your own blood and also the Holy Spirit and the will for our own life and ministry. Lord, I pray that you may talk to these dear brothers and sisters, dear friends. Let them come closer to you, open their hearts and receive the cup that you offered to them, so that they will be able to prepare themselves and do God's work and bring many people into your own kingdom. I give you all the glory, O Lord. I give you all the glory. Let me serve you till the last breath. In Jesus' almighty name I pray. Amen. The Lord bless you, friends. The Lord keep you.